Sometimes I think, what will people say of me when I'm only just a memory? When I'm home where my soul belongs, was I love when no one else would show up? Was I Jesus to the least of us? Was my worship more than just a song? I want to live like that and give it all I have, so that everything I say and do points to you. If love is who I am, then this is where I'll stand. Recklessly abandoned, never holding back. I wanna live like that. Am I proof that you are who you say you are? That grace can really change a heart? Do I live like your love is true? People pass, and even if they don't know my name, is there evidence that I've been changed? When they see me, do they see you? I want to live like that and give it all I have, so that everything I say and do points to you. If love is who I am, then this is where I'll stand. Recklessly abandoned, never holding back. I want to show the world the love you gave for me.
I wanna live like
I'm longing for the world to know the glory of the King. I wanna live like that and give it all I have, so that everything I say and do points to you. Love is who I am, and this is where I'll stand. Recklessly abandoned, never holding back. I wanna live like that. I wanna live like that.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Waterway Church. It's so good to have you here, and we hope that you are ready to worship God this morning. What an honor and privilege it is to be able to come together as a group of believers to worship God. I invite you to stand, and I'm going to pray, and then we're going to sing. God, we have gathered here this morning to worship you. God, we ask that your Spirit would move in our hearts this morning as we sing, as we hear from your word, God, so that we can become more like Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Let's sing.
Yeah.
water you turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Water you turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. There's none like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. There's none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then what could stand? Is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Good morning, church. Not sure how to follow that. Thank you, worship team. Our God is indeed greater. I hope you know that this morning. Welcome to Waterway again. We're an evangelical Mennonite congregation, and glad to see you here. My name is Reuben Bender. I'm an elder here at church. A couple words of announcement and housekeeping items. If you have questions about children, we do have staff nurseries, staffed 2 and 3 year olds running all morning. We'll have during the sermon time a place for the 4 year olds, and I believe up till fifth grade this this morning. There's also coloring books back there if you need something to stay quiet while you're in here, but we're glad you're all here. If you didn't notice, we're a bi-level now, we had Sunday school up in the second floor this morning. If you haven't checked it out, huge praise. It's been months in the making, but more Sunday school room and space, hopefully to glorify God in. But take a trip upstairs after the service if you haven't checked it out. Many people to thank, of course God to thank most of all, but excited to have that done. And tying into that, we do have a couple extra Sunday school electives that started this morning. So hopefully there were people upstairs as well as the normal Sunday schools we have in the sanctuary here. Also, starting next week, another Sunday school exploring membership class. Pastor Jesse will lead that. For anyone interested in the history of the church, what it means to be a member here, and to serve together as people at Waterway. A couple things going on this week. Check out your bulletins for extra info, but I'll highlight a couple. Today at 3:00, you've probably heard there's a concert at Oxford Presbyterian Church. The group Then Sings My Soul, so check that out. They sing hymns, songs of the Billy Graham Crusades. The concert's by donation. I believe all are welcome. And the senior adults who are going are invited back to Waterway afterwards for some refreshments. Just a reminder, there's a prayer box out in the lobby for prayer concerns. Fill out the connection card and return that there if you haven't yet. And the offering is in the back for our offerings. Let's check out for devotions, Titus, the book of Titus, chapter 2. I'd encourage you to turn there. I'm going to be reading a couple verses that won't be on the screen. If you're like me, you probably haven't checked out Titus recently enough. Read through it this afternoon. It'll take you about 15 minutes. There's a lot of good things in Titus teaching on the church. So Titus, Paul is writing to Titus, who is a convert to Christianity. In chapter 1, you'll see Paul leaves Titus in Crete to kind of set up the church there to build the church in that city. Chapter 1's full of teaching on how to build a church, you know, selecting elders, what an elder, what qualifications an elder should have, overseers, those qualifications. He gets into some things in the end of chapter 1 about, hey, there's this teaching that's contrary to the word, so don't follow that. That's where we find ourselves in chapter 2. Chapter 2, verse 1, you, however, must teach what is appropriate to sound doctrine. That's what we're trying to do here. As elders, we spend a lot of time saying, is this sound doctrine? Is this biblical? Sunday school curriculum, maybe something changed with the provider and we don't think it's sound doctrine anymore, so we got to find new curriculum. But Paul's telling Titus, hey, there's teaching out there that are contrary to the word of God. Don't follow them. You, however, teach what is appropriate to sound doctrine. We're trying to do that here at Waterway. Verse 2, teach the older men. Any older men here today? I didn't know what I'd... I got one admission out of that. I wasn't sure what the response would be. He says, teach the older men to be temperate, worthy of respect, self-controlled, and sound in faith, in love, and in endurance. Verse 3, likewise, teach the older women to be reverent in the way they live, not to be slanderers or addicted to much wine, but to teach what is good. Then they can urge the younger women. Sorry, I'm getting ahead of myself. That's verse 3. So we're studying the kingdom life and different facets of what it means to be in the kingdom of God as we live in the kingdom of the world at the same time. Today, Pastor Steve will be preaching about kingdom grandparenting, I think is the title. So we see here Paul is teaching to Titus, to the church, about what it means to be an older man, an older woman in the church, how to live. But I think it goes beyond that. As we seek to live here at Waterway, and as Titus urges the church in Crete and throughout the world, he goes on in verse 4, which won't be on the screen, but he kind of takes it a step farther. He's been telling the older people, this is how you live, but there's more to it than that. Verse 4, then they can urge, I believe he's referring to the older women that he talked about in verse 3, then the older women urge the younger women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled and pure, to be busy at home and to be kind, and to be subject to their husbands so that no one will malign the word of God. He goes on in verse 6. He says, similarly, encourage the young men. So Titus, so older men, just like the older women are to encourage the younger women, older men encourage the young men in verse 6 to be self-controlled. Maybe we shouldn't be complaining about the next generation, but teaching in verse 7, in everything set them an example by doing what is good. In your teaching, show integrity, seriousness, and soundness of speech that cannot be condemned, so that those who oppose you may be ashamed because they have nothing bad to say about us. So we see here the generational teaching, not just living out the Christianity as we look at the older population around us, but teaching it to the next generation. There's all kinds of teaching that go on in the church. I think for myself, this podium here is what I'm drawn to when you think about the church teaching. Think about Pastor Jesse or Pastor Steve. I think that's just the tip of the iceberg when it comes to teaching and the church living out its call on earth. We have small groups here at Waterway. I'd encourage you all to be plugged into one of those. We have Sunday schools for the children. Teachers that do a fabulous job. Embarrass my wife, but she teaches second and third, and I heard about a banana and orange demonstration that sounded pretty interesting to me. So if you have a second and third year old, ask about that. But teachers that do a great job teaching the kids about the Word of God. We have youth group. Just a lot of ways to be plugged in. But I think maybe even more than that, the teaching that goes on between generations, not even on Sunday mornings or on church property, but just living out life. I believe there's a lot of opportunity for mentorships between generations. I think there's a lot of young people and not just school-age kids. I think there's 20-year-olds, there's 30-year-olds, 35-year-olds. They would just long to have someone come alongside them that's older and say, hey, you're doing a great job, or keep it up. People that long to have parents or grandparent figures that don't currently, that need that. So as it says here in Titus, and as Steve will encourage us, let's live multi-generationally as a church and preach that word of God throughout the generations as we live. Some prayer requests. A lot of health concerns through the bulletin and email. We were praying for Patrick Whitmer, Clarendon Ella's grandson. A note from them this morning. I believe he had surgery on Thursday this week. They say, thank you for the prayers on behalf of Patrick. In order for him to get out of the ICU, he needs to be fever-free and off of oxygen. The operation was a huge success. Thanks to God above. So we'll continue to pray for Patrick. Also lift up Jim Herr, Gladys Audifer, Ed Zug, Dennis Hoffman had surgery earlier this week and is home recovering. Phil Lane, Paula Swain, and also John Coverly. I want to lift up Harold and Edna Martin, who are at Landis Homes as well. Starting March, so our prayer partner for this month will be our missions partner, the Oaks Ministry which is right across the street and also in various locations. And also Mennonite Central Committee, which is worldwide in their reach. So we'll pray for them as we support them financially as well this month. Will you join me in prayer this morning, church? Lord, I thank you for the older men and older women here and those in our lives who have influenced us to be who we are. Thank you for those who have gone before us and set an example of how to live, not just live for ourselves, but to live for you. I want to think of Harold and Edna Martin this morning. Thank you for their lives of service and faithfulness to you. And as they live out their last days, I pray that they could do that well, that they could be encouraged. Father, help us to not just live well, but to pass that on to the next generations so that we can see your church move even past our lifetime. Thank you for the privilege that it is to be the church and to work together, young or old. Father, we have many prayer concerns, many health issues, people recovering from surgery. Pray that you would continue your healing. Father, work in our hearts more than anything to keep us focused on you, no matter what's going on in our lives. Help our lives to point to you. Father, our vision is that all we know might be more like you and your son, Jesus. Help us to work that out well. Help us, first of all, in our own lives to be growing in you so that we can encourage others to grow, to know you and serve you better. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Stand with us, excuse me, in our time of song. If I can get my voice in here. Anyone dealing with a cold this week? That's me too. yeah, fun times. Well, hey, let's sing some songs here. We're going to start out with a older medley that we haven't done in a little while. And
there is no other name.
I'm sorry. We're going to start
that's
with
the second one.
That's the second one. Yeah. I need to get my facts straight here. Sorry. I did practice this morning. I promise you. All right, let's be. Well, on that note, let's begin in worship together. All right.
There is no other name by which men can be saved. There is no other name under heaven. There is rest for my soul, and the wounded made whole, and the practice set free and forgiven. There is no other name by which men can be saved. There is no other name under heaven. There is rest for my soul, and the wounded made whole, and the captive set free and forgiven. Such love as I never know. This is why my heart and soul and tongue confess. There is no other name by which men can be saved. There is no other name under heaven. There is rest for my soul, and the wounded made whole, and the captive set free and forgiven. I'd never known. I am found in the grace that flowed to me. In my unrighteousness, this is why my heart and soul and tongue confess. There is no other name by which men can be saved. There is no other name under heaven.
There is rest for my soul, and the wounded made whole, and the captive set free and forgiven. There is no other name by which men can be saved. There is no other name under heaven. There is rest for my soul, and the wounded made whole, and the captive set free and forgiven.
Now we're going to do the medley. We're going to start out with Amazing Grace. I think you all know this one. Join with us.
Already come. moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you.
Promises. That is who you are. And we worship you this morning, Lord. Amen. Amen. Hope you all believe that in your hearts. You may be seated.
It is time to dismiss the children for Children's Church and Waterway 2-5. So if you are age 4 through first grade or second grade up to grade 5, it's time for Children's Ministries. Great. All right. Boy, what a crowd. Awesome.
I guess everyone's here.
I guess everyone is here. Yeah. And it's a good thing everyone's here, because I know you're going to have a great time in class, having fun and learning about Jesus. So that's awesome. All right, well, let's pray before you go to class, okay? Dear God, thank you that we have the opportunity to have classes for children. And Lord, I pray for the teachers today. God, help them to teach really well. God, I pray for the students. I pray for all these children. God, that you would help them to listen well. Because God, we want to help people to become more like Jesus. And we ask God that you would help us to do that today in our classes. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. All right, have fun in class. Well, I noticed this morning that we have a number of our college students with us. So I'm taking it spring break time. I saw the Davis kids. Well, no, they were over here earlier. They're over here now. Oh, they're switching it up on me. So welcome back from Penn State. I saw Emily Smoker. Didn't I see? No, Elizabeth Smoker. Elizabeth Smoker. She was here somewhere. There's Elizabeth. Welcome. Bryce. I know I saw Bryce earlier, too. There's Bryce. Welcome back. Did I miss anybody? There was the ones I saw, anyway. So good to have you guys here. Elizabeth, nice tan. Wow. Now, where were you?
Jamaica.
No wonder you have such a nice tan. Wow, good. Well, hey, guys, welcome. It's good to have you guys back. Good to see you guys here this morning. We are in a series called Kingdom Living, how we can live in the kingdom of God, how we should be living in the kingdom of God. Because we are children of God. And we're taking a look at what it means to live as a children of the King here in this world. And of course, we become a child of God when we believe that Jesus died on the cross for our sins. As we are sinners, there's no way that we can get to heaven, but because Jesus died on the cross for our sins, and we acknowledge him as our Savior, we become a child of the King. But living here on this earth, we also understand that we are caught in another kingdom. We are caught in Satan's kingdom here on this earth, because God has not yet set up his kingdom here. So we're kind of caught in the middle between living as a child of God and living here in this kingdom. In fact, Peter writes this in 1 Peter 2. He says, you know, you are aliens and strangers living here. And people view us as aliens and strangers because we don't conform to the culture, we don't conform to the views of this world. Well, today, Jesse assigned me the topic of grandparenting in the kingdom of God and what that means. Grandparenting in the kingdom of God and what that means. Now, some of you are saying, okay, well, I'm not a grandparent, so I don't have to listen. Well, not quite. Hold on. Some of you are saying, well, I don't have any grandchildren, so it's okay. You listen. Some of you don't have any grandparents living anymore, or grandchildren yet, or have no children to have grandchildren. That, hold tight, because it's going to affect you as well. So what I'm trying to say is that I think everyone, as you leave here this morning, are going to be able to walk away with something as we try to live as children of the King. A little over a week ago, I was talking to my granddaughter on FaceTime. And that's one of the things that I have learned as I get older, is that trying to connect with grandkids gets interesting, especially when they're 2 hours away. But FaceTime works well. So we were talking and chatting and catching up. And I said, oh, by the way, I'm going to be talking about grandparenting. Hey, why don't you make a video about your grandparents? This is what she sent me.
My grandparents are the absolute best. They always make funny faces and will do anything to put a smile on your face. Another thing I love about grandparents is they are always willing to go and have fun with you. They will never turn down an adventure.
As you can see, she has been influenced by her grandmother. According to research, grandparents have the second most powerful influence in a child's life. According to research, grandparents have the second most powerful influence in a child's life. We have a great responsibility. We have a lot of responsibility to help shape the next generation as grandparents. Actually, as adults, we have a great responsibility to help shape the next generation. One of the amazing facts about children is how much that they learn just by listening and observing. They're like little sponges that just absorb what is happening around them. God knew that that is how children are, because He created people. And in doing so, He gave a command. He says, you know, since children are this way, I want you to do this. So as the children were about to enter the promised land, now they just come out of Egypt, they were slaves in Egypt, they're entering their promised land. God's like, okay, look, we get a chance to reset. We can hit the reset button here. We can start over again. And this is what I want you to do. Deuteronomy 4:9. Please turn your Bibles or turn your devices to Deuteronomy 4:9. We're going to be spending our time there this morning. Deuteronomy 4:9. It's interesting, when I would speak And I would tell people to turn your Bibles, and you would hear all this rustling of pages, you know, to get to the passage. Nowadays, people turn on their devices. I can't hear a thing. So I don't know if you're turning to the passage or not. So I was like, okay, well, are they there? I don't know, because I don't hear much. So I'm taking for granted that you have turned to Deuteronomy 4:9 or have it on your device. It says this, only be careful and watch yourselves closely so that you do not forget the things your eyes have seen or let them fade from your heart as long as you live. Teach them to your children and to their children after them. Let's go back to the first part of that. Only be careful and watch yourselves closely. Grandparents, that's on us to be careful with how we live. Watch ourselves closely about how we act, how we talk, the things that we do, because it's coming. Watch yourselves closely. 31 times in the Bible, we as grandparents, you as adults, are told to watch yourselves closely. Because what we do affects the next generation. So God told Moses, warn the people, watch yourselves closely. Why? So that you do not forget the things your eyes have seen or let them fade from your heart as long as you live. Don't forget the things that you have seen. And again, the context is the children of Israel are about ready to enter the promised land. And the parents and the grandparents, they have seen so much as the miracles in Egypt, the plagues that happened, and then the miracles in the desert as they were trying to get to the promised land, and how God fed them with manna and quail and water came from the rocks and, you know, just stuff that you could not explain away. It had to be a miracle. And so God's telling Moses, tell the people, do not forget the things that your eyes have seen. Don't let it ever fade from your heart as long as you live. You know, even their clothes did not wear out. Don't forget what I have done for you, children of Israel. It's important. Now you might be thinking, okay, what has God done for me? I mean, I don't have manna. Kind of glad about that. I'm really not into quail. What has God done for me? I tell you what he's done for you. He has saved your soul as a Christian. He has taken you out of the kingdom of darkness that you were headed to hell and has placed you into his kingdom. You are now adopted as God's child. And now you have the hope of heaven that you're going to be there one day. God has changed you on the inside. He has made you a new creature. Man, there are many things that we can share. Many things that we can share. What God has done for us. He has set us on a new path in life. He has given us a new passion in life. So don't think, well, I'm not sure what God has done for me. Well, let me go on. As a Christian, he has given you spiritual gifts so that you can be useful in his service. God has blessed you with every spiritual blessing that you need. God has sheltered you. He has protected you. He is watching over you. Sometimes we don't take time to realize all that God has done for us. But you know what? God said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. We have lots of things to remember. We have lots of things to be able to pass on to the next generation. And the reason we are to remember this is so that we can teach them to your children and to their children after them. We are to remember these things to teach our kids and to our grandchildren. Now, look, I know that when your grandparents say, well, when I was your age, all of a sudden the eyes start rolling. Oh, man, okay. Do we have to hear these stories again? Yes, because we are commanded to in the Bible. Just read Deuteronomy 4:9. So when grandma and grandpa say, well, when I was your age, listen, because they're fulfilling God's command in their life to you. Because they are passing on their knowledge. Because you know what? It was tough for my grandparents to make it through the recession. Man, it was tough. They shared stories of how they made it. That's an encouragement to me. Because you know what? When times get tough, well, you know what? My grandparents made it. Maybe I can too. That's why we tell stories to our children about, hey, you know, when I was your age. Now, I know you walked to school uphill both ways in the snow without boots. Yeah, I know. But you know what? We share stories because there's a lesson to be learned. And we are fulfilling our biblical principle to teach them to our children and to our grandchildren. In fact, you know what? God has entrusted to grandparents and to parents a spiritual legacy that we have to pass on, that we will pass on. God has entrusted us to pass on that spiritual legacy. Do you remember your first grandchild holding that first grandbaby in your arms? Man, I sure do. I had to drive 10 hours to Indiana. It was a long drive. But that precious little person that was entrusted to us, all of a sudden my name changed from Dad to Pop Pop. My role was expanded because I now had another person in my family to influence and impact. When our children are born, we as a parent are the center of the world. Even though we couldn't love our grandchildren more, even if we tried, their attachment to us as grandparents is not hardwired. They weren't born to listen for our voices or search for our eyes. We had to introduce ourselves as grandparents, which is why I think we just love spoiling our grandchildren, because we want to introduce ourselves to them. We want to create a connection with them. And it seems like our culture gives us a free pass to spoil our grandkids with all kinds of indulgences that we never lavished on our children. You are important to your grandchildren in many ways. As a grandparent, you carry a lot of weight in what you say and in what you do and how you act. In a child's world, the mom and dad is the ultimate authority. But as a grandparent, your role is to be there to support and encourage and influence them. And we can do that through our life and our story. As I was researching this past week, I came across a guy by the name of Larry Fowler. Larry Fowler, maybe you've heard him speak on Focus on the Family. At age 63, he started a new ministry called Legacy Coalition. And part of the ministry of Legacy Coalition is having a grandparent summit. And I'm going to share with you some things that he shares at these grandparent summits. And I'm going to give you the Reader's Digest version so we get out before lunch, okay? Number one, as a grandparent, understand your impact potential. Understand your impact potential, and that, as I already said, you have a lot of impact. Number two, know your role. Know your role. You are not the parents, you are the grandparent. But yet, as the grandparent, it is your responsibility to help pass along a spiritual legacy. Because you are to remember what God has done for you, and you are to tell that story to the next generation. That is part of your role. That takes intention. It doesn't just happen, it takes intention. We have a very clear mandate to pass along our faith to the next generation. I want to take a look at Psalm 78, 5 and 6. It'll be up here on the screen. Psalm 78, 5 and 6. He, that's God, commanded our ancestors to teach their children so the next generation would know them, God's principles, even the children yet to be born, and they in turn will tell their children. The principle of passing down a spiritual legacy from Psalm 78. The third thing that Larry Fowler says is model a life of goodness. That's why Deuteronomy 4:9 says, watch yourselves closely. Model a life of goodness. You know, sometimes the older I get, the easier it is to get cranky and to complain about things. Those stupid kids are so loud and noisy. Why don't they slow down? They have to run everywhere. Don't we? It's pretty easy to fall into that kind of mentality. Model a life of goodness. Know and recognize that they are children. And guess what? They are going to act like children. Because that is who they are. Number four, create great relationships with the parents. Now, this is for everybody. We as grandparents need to work on the relationship with our children. But you know what, children? You need to work on a relationship with your parents, because grandparents are second in influence on your children. So work on a great relationship with your parents. Grandparents, we need to work on having a great relationship with our kids. Because if we don't, as grandparents, we're not going to have that open door to be with our grandchildren. It's not always easy, because you know what? They don't always do what I think they ought to do as parents. That was kind of dumb. And you are going to do what? When last fall, my daughter and son-in-law said, hey, we're going to go to Turkey for 2 weeks to help at a mission there to work with orphans from the Ukraine war. And my wife and I both thought, no. And we had a long conversation with our son and daughter-in-law because to leave their kids who are 8th grade, 5th grade, and 2 in 2nd grade. Did I get it right, Donna? Good. It's like, you're going to leave them for 2 weeks? Especially if one has attachment issues? Yeah, we don't always agree, do we? But developing a good relationship is important. And if you don't have a good relationship, don't give up. Don't give up with your kids, because your grandkids are too important. Work on understanding where your kids are coming from. Work on clarifying questions so that you can understand what they are thinking. And even in the end, you may not agree, but as the parent, you are to love unconditionally. You are to forgive unconditionally, because your grandchildren are too important. Number 5, balance grace and truth. At our small group, right, Pfeiffer's, right, Fetterman's, we just talked about that at our small group this past week, what it means to balance grace and truth, to not come down too hard on the truth side. You better do this. With the grace side, you know, I understand why you did that. I don't agree with it, but let's talk about it. How we can balance between grace and truth. John 1:14 describes Jesus, who was full of grace and truth. It should be translated, Jesus was full of grace and full of truth. You know, the older I get, the more firmly I hold on to what the Bible says. You know what? I don't care anymore what people think. This is what the Bible says. You better do it. But I have to watch myself, because you know what? Jesus was full of grace as well. Not just truth, but grace as well. Sometimes it's my nature to respond with advice and opinions. Yep, this is what I think, and you need to do that. Right, Wilmer? That's how we are. This is the way it is. Now do it. Or maybe I can prepare the soil of my kids and my grandkids by coming at them with grace and love, and let's talk about it, instead of coming at them with, well, here's what you need to do. You know, I think the story in the Gospels of the woman caught in adultery. When the men brought to this woman caught in adultery, they were absolutely right. She was to be stoned. Jesus didn't say, don't stone her, because that was the law. But Jesus treated her with grace. And at the very end, after he showed love and forgiveness towards this person, Jesus then said, leave your life of sin. Don't do it anymore. Jesus modeled what it meant to have grace. They also modeled what it meant to give the truth, because we must do it. Number 6. Boy, this is a hard one, especially for us older people. Adapt to your grandkids' world. You know, my grandparents never had FaceTime. Good grief, I had to go see them to talk to them or see them in person. Now we can pick up the phone and do FaceTime, and it's pretty cool. It's pretty cool because I can interact with them, well, when they're available, but any day of the week, pick up the phone, do FaceTime, and you know what? Almost always, they're glad to talk to us. You know, how many of your grandkids are into video games? Oh, my soul, I can't even figure out what to do half the time. You know, they are flying so fast with their fingers on the controllers. It's like, how did you do that? What do you do? And you know what? They crush me every time we play a game. I am terrible at Mario Kart. They beat me every time. You know what? I can think of a lot more fun things to do than sit in front of a TV and play video games. But you know what? They love it. They enjoy it. And you know what? If they can get joy out of beating me at Mario Kart, good for them. Because they can tell their friends that, oh, I beat Pop-Pop every time. And they do. With technology, it's hard to keep up. I know, being an older person, it's hard. You do what? But you know what? As grandparents, if we want to have an influence and impact on our grandkids, we need to adapt to their world. As I was thinking through this stuff, I thought, I wonder what our kids here think of their grandparents. So I asked them. I said, hey, what makes your grandparents special? What makes your grandparents special? Here are some of their comments. They play board games with me. Keep going. They make good food. I love this one. Nanny makes amazing desserts. They play memory game with me. As long as we have a memory, we'll play a game. They give me candy. Yes. They go to their house. Oh, I get to go to their house when my parents go away. They make me laugh. And I found that's because I'm usually doing something stupid. I didn't try it, but they just, you know, just the way it goes. They care well for all of us. They take us out to eat and have a sleepover for my birthday. I can ride with Pop-Pop in his truck. This last one's my favorite. My papa has a whole basement full of trains. You bet. They get me whatever I want. Just know, parents, that's because we're trying to build a connection with your kids, okay? So we get to spoil them rotten. We get to do those fun things. And then this last one. They teach me things. Pretty cool. Now, this was kindergarten through fifth grade. That was the response from kindergarten through fifth grade. Then I asked the sixth graders, sixth to 12th graders, said, hey, what have you learned from your grandparents? What have you learned? I have learned how to handle different situations. My grandma taught me how to put the string back into my sweatshirt. My grandma taught me how to sew. This next one really got me. My grandparents taught me how to deal with one of my friends who was going through a lot. How to dig sweet potatoes. Everybody got to know how to do that. How to play baseball. How to play ping pong. Get this next one. How to help your siblings and love them when it is hard. Man, I started wiping tears away. How to show love and respect to people. What a healthy and encouraging marriage looks like. to not grow up too fast or act older than you really are. To cook some good food. And then about when they were young. Now let me tell you a story when I was your age. You know what? You grandparents are doing a really good job. You grandparents are hitting it out of the park, folks. Good job. Good job. Keep it up. Keep up the good work about being intentional of passing down a spiritual legacy. Now I want to talk to the grandkids just for a second. You know, we are old. We don't move as fast as we used to. There are times where we would love to play kickball with you in the backyard or play a game that we just can't quite do it. Have some patience with us because we do love you. We do care about you. And we do want to pass down a spiritual legacy to you. For you see, grandkid, you're in a family because that is God's design. Because God wants people to impact your life. He wants people to show you how to live, to how to respond. God wants to show you the way of God. That's why he puts you in a family, so that you can have people who love and care for you do those things. Yeah, kids, our lives have changed dramatically. I had a phone attached to a wall when I was growing up. You know, if I had to call somebody, I had to sit in the kitchen and talk to them with my mom or dad or and everybody else right there. You know, our TV was, we didn't have a TV for a while, but, you know, our TV was a little black and white. You know, the screen was like this big, and the console was like this big that it was in, you know? You know, our world has changed dramatically, kids. We are trying to keep up. We are trying our best to keep up. So have some patience with us. And you know what, grandkids? Thank you, thank you, thank you for helping us with our tech to figure out how our phone works and how our computer works. We appreciate that very much. And we will do our best. We will do our best to pass along a spiritual legacy in the best way we know how. Yeah, it might not, you know, hit your button, say, well, that was really good. I'm glad they did that. Yeah, you know, maybe not. But we are trying to pass on a spiritual legacy to you. Be patient with us. And know that God has put you in a family so that we can do that. If you're here this morning and you don't have any children, know that just being here in this place, you are influencing the kids. You saw all those kids up, I don't know how many were up here, 30 kids? It's amazing. By you being here, you are influencing and impacting those children because they are watching, they are seeing what happens. Know that your life is having an impact on them. And you know what? It's okay to say hi to them. It's okay to fist bump them. Hey, glad you're here this morning. You know what? That will impact those kids for a long time, knowing that someone recognizes them and, hey, I'm glad you're here, giving them a fist bump. You can have an impact. If you don't have any kids or grandkids, you can still have an impact. I'm done. Isn't that what we say? Grandparents, all right, I'm done. It's over. I hope that you take this to heart. It touched me as I was thinking through this week. It was like, boy, Steve, you missed it here, man. You need to be more intentional about contacting your kids, your grandkids. You know, believe me, I am so, so jealous and envious of some of you grandparents to have grandkids 2 minutes away. Man, that just kills me. Mine are 50 minutes away and 2 hours away. See, I have to be very, very intentional about touching my kids, my grandkids. And it's hard because sometimes life gets in the way. But grandparents, do it. Because you are the second most influential person in your grandchild's life. You need to do it. Parents, let us do it. Let us spoil them rotten. You know, that's our job. Because we love them. We love them to death. And we want to have an impact on their lives. Let's stand together. We're going to pray, and then we're going to sing. God, it's pretty amazing that in the book of Deuteronomy, you are talking to grandparents, and you are telling them to pass down the stories of what God has done for them so that no one forgets. God, thank you for what you have done for us in saving us from our sins, in giving us a new passion for you, a new purpose in life to serve you, and the hope of heaven one day. God, thank you. God, remind us as grandparents to be intentional. God, remind me to be intentional to reach out to my grandkids. God, I pray for the grandkids here, the young ones and even the older ones who still have grandparents alive. God, may we be open to their wisdom, to their stories of when they were young and what it was like to handle the different situations that came up in life. God, thanks. Thanks for putting us in this place that we can do that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's all sing The Solid Rock as we end our service this morning.
I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
All right, grandparents, go and impact and influence your grandkids. And grandkids, let us do it because we want to do it. And because we have to do it because we are commanded to do it. So when we say, when I was your age, or let me tell you a story when I was young, you listen good because you can learn. And we're passing down that spiritual legacy. The second floor is almost finished. We still have the stair treads to put in yet. We're still waiting on the final elevator inspection. But you know what? Go take a look at the second floor. It's awesome. What a space to help us in our ministry here. It's just exciting. And you know what? It's all paid for. We don't have to ask you for a penny. I know. I was totally blown away. And on top of that, Matt Hershey at our last leadership team said, you know what? I think we have $200,000 to pay down the debt on this building. And we were like, huh? So coming in, I think it's April, right, Matt? Coming in April, we're going to be paying down probably over $200,000 on the debt on this building. So that should take us to about $400,000 left, Matt, out of over $1 million loan that we had 2 years ago. Folks, it's just unbelievable. Unbelievable. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you for responding to God's call on your life and following through what God has prompted you to do. It's just amazing. Jesse and I just were like, wow, God is so good. We just can't believe all that is happening here at this church. We are just amazed at the grace of God. It's a fun journey, folks. It's a fun journey. I'm excited to walk on this journey with you. So be the church as you exit today. Be the church.